WNDS Sports presents Candlepin Stars and Strikes, featuring the best Candlepin bowlers from all over New England, and now in our 15th season. Your hosts for Candlepin Stars and Strikes, Dick Glutz and Mike Moore.
Hi again, everyone, and welcome in to another edition of Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV. From Lita Lanes in Nashua, New Hampshire, Dick Lutz with Mike Moore, and it's the 15th season of Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV. For Michael and I, it's our third year together, and it's consistently the top-rated show on WNDS-TV, which goes to show the dedication and loyalty of fans of Candlepin Bowling.
Yeah, Candlepin Bowling fans have never wavered for their enthusiasm of the game, and certainly we appreciate the loyalty to the program. It's been a long summer, and it's great to be back. Six brand-new ladder series, and Dick, once again this year, mixed doubles in the winter.
And we're headed toward a tournament of champions at the end of it all, and let's meet our bowlers in our first match of this new season on Candlepin Stars and Strikes. Our fifth seed from Newington, New Hampshire, is Mike Poulin.
Mike Poulin has not been around for the last couple of years, but he is back, and this was originally his home lanes. Mike Poulin coming in with an average of 125, his high single is 199, high triple is 477. Mike is from Newington these days and does his bowling on the seacoast at Bowlerama Lanes in Portsmouth.
And he bowled a 649 to gain the number 5 seed in our first ladder series, and he'll be taking on the fourth seed, Jim Grigaitis from Brockton.
We saw Jimmy a couple of years ago, and he's back once again. We're happy to have him. His average is 123. High single, 194. Jim's high triple is 466. Still does his bowling at the Hanson Bowlodrome in Hanson, Massachusetts.
A 664 total is his roll-off score, and he's the number 4 seed. Up the ladder we go. It's our first series of our new season on Candlepin Stars and Strikes, and we're back with our first match right after this from Lita Lanes in Nashua, New Hampshire on WNDS-TV. First match of the new season begins with fifth seed Mike Poulin taking on number 4 Jim Grigaitis. On top of the ladder, Bob Betancourt, Bruno DeFeo, and Chris Sargent. Waiting in the wings, we're ready to go with our first match. And first to bowl will be Mike Poulin from Newington, New Hampshire, and we're underway at Lita Lanes in Nashua, New Hampshire. Happy to have you with us for another season of Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV. First ball punches right through.
And we spent a lot of time. We spent a lot of time last season talking about the half Worcester. Let's hope that we don't have to talk too much about it this year.
And he almost converts it. Mike Poulin on the line for our first match. We'll tell you a little bit about Mike. And he picks up a 9 box to begin. Mike rolls out of the Bowlerama in Portsmouth. He's been bowling 34 years, 20 as a professional, and has been on WNDS-TV 20 times. And on the old Channel 5 show, he was on another 20 times over the course of its duration. He's a design consultant and in-ground pool specialist working for two companies, Custom Pools and Efficient Air Systems, over in the Seacoast area. And misses the attempted spare. He and Judy have been married for 19 years. They have 3 children, Stephen, 15, Tommy, 13, and David, 12. And he starts off with a 9 and a 7. And that brings Jim Grigaitis to the line. Jim is from Brockton, Massachusetts, no stranger to television bowling. Been on Channel 50 4 times over the past several years. 3 singles competitions, 1 of the skins matches. And he was on Channel 5 another half dozen times. He's 39 years old, a customer service rep with Hill Pet Nutrition, the makers of Science Diet. You with pets are familiar with that.
So my cats eat the new hairball reduction diet, actually.
He and his wife, Diane, have 2 children, a son, James, 8, who is here today, and a daughter, Kristen, who is 4 years old. And Jim starts out with a 10 box.
Well, on paper, these two gentlemen are pretty evenly matched with averages just a couple of pins apart, high singles just a few pins apart, and high triple 11 pins apart, and roughly the same age. So it shapes up on paper anyway, Dick, to be a good match.
We talked about the high ratings that the Candlepin Stars and Strikes show has enjoyed on WNDS over the years, repeatedly the top-rated show on the station week after week. And Mike Morin, of course, is no stranger to ratings because his radio station, WZID-FM in Manchester, is the top-rated station in Manchester. Recent ratings in the spring were unbelievable. They were just unbelievable.
We thank everybody, including my mother, who lives in Michigan and still fills a rating book in for me.
A nine box for Jim Grigaitis. He takes an early three-pin lead. What was it, 2-1 over the nearest competition?
Pretty close
like
to that. Yeah, very close to that.
It's unheard of in radio ratings. Mike Poulin into the second pocket leaves a spare opportunity with the 1-3-6 still standing. Does not convert.
Still looking for our first mark of our 15th season.
Well, the show on Channel 5 lasted what? Something close to 40 years.
Yes.
We've got a ways to go to catch him, but we'll give it our best shot.
We'll be in our, what, 80s, Dick, when that gets to that point. Is anybody going to still want to watch us then?
This crew will still be here, the fans. That
the fans will be, yeah.
Year after year, week after week, you get a good look at them right there. Another big crowd at Lita Lane's for our first taping session. 10 box for Mike Poulin. Back-to-back 10s.
That's a spare.
It was a spare. All right. Let's give him a spare. Let's be fair about it.
First mark.
First mark.
That's it. And, of course, three in a row is bonus money for $50.
We start out with $500 in our triple strike jackpot. $50 for three marks in a row, $25 for each mark after that. And if one of our bowlers should be fortunate enough to put four strikes back to back to back to back, it would be worth $1,000.
Second to last show last year in the Tournament of Champions ladder, Rich Clark had a three-bagger and won $1,375.
Seven bucks for Jim Grigaitis. Now he's up against the Mike Poulin spare in the fourth frame. I want to take a moment to thank all of you viewers who took the time during the summer months to write to us. There are a lot of letters. We're going to try to get to as many as we can in the weeks ahead, and we certainly would encourage you to continue writing. We'd love to hear from you. Trying to play the wood.
Very
look at
nice.
That shot. What a great shot by Jim Grigaitis to match the spare of Mike Poulin in the fourth frame. That is a big time conversion for Jim Grigaitis. Watch it again. He played that wood perfectly off the right side. He gambled and won, and the spare for Grigaitis. Now Poulin on the spare, puts six in it.
Couldn't get the ball to climb the hill all the way to the head pin, leaves the four horsemen on the right side, and he'll go left to right on this shot.
Looks good. He's got two in a row. Our first opportunity at bonus money this afternoon. The lefty, Mike Poulin, looking for some extra cash. That time on the head pin, cannot break up the split.
That's not the one he wanted to fall. Got some wood to work with, but it isn't real helpful, I don't think. This is a $50 shot if the 5-7 goes.
Well, if it's touching, then he's got an opportunity to go right for the 7 pin and hope to catch the dead wood and trip the five from behind. No, they're not. That's not how he played it. Well, the bonus money goes back into the vault. There for Jim Grigaitis, who works on a mark.
Want to mention our runner-up today wins $100. Also want to mention, as a value-added prize this year, all our winners are going to receive a $50 gift certificate from Haverhill Beef Company on Merrimack Street in Haverhill, and we'll tell you more about them. And we're glad to have them on board, adding some extra incentive for our bowlers this year.
Good conversion for Grigaitis after the spread eagle. He picked up three on each side for the 10 box. A 10-pin lead for Mike Poulin. Just off the head pin.
Well, after punching through last time, you can understand his apprehension to going flush to the 1-2-3 pocket again.
We had an opportunity to meet Joe Terrazano of Haverhill Beef before the match today. He's a longtime bowler in Haverhill. And we're happy to have him aboard.
When you go into the store, you actually see the people that you see on his television commercials, family members. Those aren't actors, folks. Those are the real Terrazanos.
10 box for Grigaitis, a 10-pin lead for Mike Poulin as we move into the seventh frame of our first string of this opening match of a new series of Candlepin Stars and Strikes. On the head pin that time. And waiting for that wood to come back. Well, it's around. Didn't take it, but certainly left him a pretty good opportunity here.
Crowd was very happy to see that pin come in front of the three. The spare.
Third spare of the first string for Mike Poulin.
Mike Poulin loves Lita Lanes. For many years, this was his home bowling center until he and his family moved closer to the seacoast to Newington. Now he bowls at the Bowlerama on Lafayette Avenue in Portsmouth.
He will put seven in the spare. Peg Webster from Wilmington, Mass. Sent in a letter, Mike, with a couple of newspaper clippings, one talking about the high ratings of Candlepin bowling on TV over the years, and another is for historian Mike Morin, bowling historian Mike Morin. Here's the question. There's an answer here, too, but I'm not going to show you the answer. How come there are 10 pins?
I can tell you why there were 9 pins for a while, but I don't really think I can tell you why there were 10.
Makes reference to 9 pins in the answer.
It became a 9-pin game for a while because I think it had something to do with the Puritans not wanting bowling to be played either on Sunday or at all, the 10-pin game as it was known at that time. So they took one pin out to create a technicality which made it 9, which then the people were able to bowl, getting around that 10-pin law. Tell you 10. All right.
As we watch Jim Grigaitis convert. Spare for Grigaitis in the seventh box. The 10-pin game was developed to avoid a ban on 9-pin.
Oh, so I had it backwards.
Bowling with 9 pins was popularized during the 15th century, but a form of bowling with a single pin, as Grigaitis converts 2 marks in a row. Strike on top of a spare, and you're going to get to see it again. Jim Grigaitis right in the pocket, in the 1-3 pocket, and there they go. Back-to-back marks, strike on top of a spare. Both bowlers warming up here in the first string. And Poulin with a spread eagle. The 10-pin game was developed to avoid a ban on 9-pin. Bowling with 9 pins was popularized during the 15th century, but a form of bowling with a single pin was common in Germany as early as the 5th century, and other forms with more pins became commonplace in German monasteries, using the long cloister passages as bowling alleys. Bowling was introduced in the United States first in New York by the Dutch and then spread to other states. Wagering became commonplace. Nah, couldn't have happened. And so did fixed matches. Eventually, Connecticut banned the game of bowling at 9 pins, but bowlers were not so easily discouraged and immediately launched the game of 10 pins. You learn something new all the time.
Thank you very much.
That's
to
from Peg Webster from Wilmington, Massachusetts.
There's always a way around something. We learned that years ago.
Poulin tries to convert. Had him going every which way. He is at 115, 116 first string for Mike Poulin. Now Jim Grigaitis working on a couple of marks. He's filling a strike.
Hoping for bonus money with a mark here.
On the head pin. Can't break up the split.
Not an easy shot with parallel wood. 5, 6, and 10.
Got to hope for something bouncing off the wall here.
I don't think it's touching either.
Oh. He'll put 9 in the strike and take the lead in the match with a 10 box. A 3-pin lead for Jim Grigaitis. Box to box, and he still has a box to go, and he'll be up against a Mike Poulin 10. On the head pin, same split, opposite side. Almost the same wood. Although he's got a piece of wood on the right that's going to fall off and not be a factor. Grigaitis at 116 right now and had the pins flying but couldn't touch the 5-pin. He is at 118 and a 119 first string for Jim Grigaitis, a 3-pin lead over Mike Poulin as we head to string number 2 in our opening match of a brand new season of Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV. We're back to lead a lane. It's right after this. Jim Grigaitis will be first to bowl in string number 2 of our opening match, taking a 3-pin lead into the middle game, a 119 for Grigaitis in the first string to Mike Poulin's 116. And Grigaitis on lane 34 at lead of lanes, right in the pocket, and look what he has to show for it. The 7 and 10, the bedposts.
Some double wood right in between.
One of the letters that we'll get to in my stack of letters here that we accumulated over the offseason is a letter with a whole bunch of different terms in bowling of different leaves. What, will he get it? Ooh, look at this. He got it to wiggle, but couldn't get it to go. Most of them are familiar, but there were a couple that were different. And a 9 box to start out for Jim Grigaitis. Got a nice letter from Raymond Lewis from Malden, Massachusetts, who is 70 years old. He's been bowling since he was 17 years old. He was a pin setter back in Dorchester and a couple of other places in Boston. But the last line of the letter is the one that I underline as Grigaitis with a 9-pin drop. Raymond Lewis writes, "I think I would rather bowl than eat." And he's been bowling in different leagues over the years. Since 1975, bowling in a summer league every summer, grew up in Roxbury in the South End, and was a pin setter and a bowler and would rather bowl than eat.
Maybe we ought to send him a gift certificate from Haverhill Beef Company. Perhaps that could change his mind.
Mike Poulin trying to get that sleeper pin to go and can't get the 8-pin to drop. It's still standing, the 2 and the 8 with some wood. Poulin starts out with a spare.
Mike Poulin, a graduate of Bishop Girton High School right here in Nashua, as he grew up in this area. 1973, of course, back then it was an all-male school. Several years ago, it merged with one of the local other high schools and it's been co-ed since the early 90s, which my daughter graduated from. Very fine school, and that's where Mike hails from.
And he has 2 marks to start the second string, the former Bishop Girton Cardinal. Now Jim Grigaitis.
Probably the best known Bishop Girton Cardinal is Mike Lupica, writer for the New York Daily News. You see him on the sports reporters on ESPN.
He'll put a 6 in the spare and a tough leave here. Almost pulled it off. Boy, he's had wood flying all afternoon, hasn't he?
He almost made the 7-10 in the first frame, picked up a second frame spare, and nearly converted this one.
And he'll take a 10 box, 35 through 3. Boy, Jim Grigaitis, talk about high schools. I don't know that Jim went to Brockton High, but that's another great high school of
boy, isn't it?
Athletic note, the Boxers.
Boxers, right.
That time on the head pin. Spare opportunity for Jim Grigaitis in the fourth frame.
He's really throwing a very lively ball. His second frame that he converted was nearly a backdoor strike. No, it was the second frame. Yes, it was, when he left only the 10 pin. And he almost got a strike on that sidewall hit.
And he'll take a spare in frame number four. Two marks and four boxes for Jim Grigaitis in the second string. And Mike Poulin's working on two for two thus far. And he's going for some bonus money. We have yet to give away bonus money. Both bowlers had three marks in the first string, but they were not consecutive. This time we have an opportunity.
Wow.
That was the five pin, is now the 5.5 pin, I think. It's the 5-8 still standing. The five moved off its mark quite a bit, leaves an opening.
You know, you could almost put the ball in between there, especially coming from his angle, from left to right. If there was a little bit of a tail on the ball, it could actually go through there.
And it cost him. It cost him dearly,
yep,
that time, the moving of the five pin. It cost him a mark. It cost him $50. And a nine box. So the pin dancing off its mark hurt Mike Poulin just then. On the head pin that time. That's how much did it hurt him? It hurt him a lot. It cost him some money. So a strike in the fourth frame for Mike Poulin. We'll look at it when we come back to Lita Lanes in Nashua, New Hampshire, as we take a break. It's Grigaitis and Poulin, match number one on Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV. Jim Grigaitis ready to go as we come back to Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV. Dick Lutzk with Mike Morin. Happy to have you with us for our season opener. Season number 15 for Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV. Grigaitis on a mark. On the head pin, leaves a split. Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV. Our director is Ken Knight. On cameras, Jim McLean, Jonathan Barraza, and Ryan Talbot. Going for the spare and not getting it. Replay machine manned by Dave McCarthy. Kevin LaFon's on graphics. Dave Hand on audio. Larry Taylor's our engineer, the official scorer. Here at Lita Lanes is Chris Beauvair, and we're all happy to have you with us for another season of Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV. A lot of the communication during the off-season months, Mike, and we got a lot of letters from you faithful viewers. Love to hear from you and encourage you to write and continue to write. People asking about the Skins program, which was on for many years on WNDS-TV. We ought to start a lobbying campaign ourselves because the people really loved that show.
Well, it was a very fast format, and there were, I believe, five bowlers on the program. So it gave more people a chance to participate. And, boy, I tell you, that half hour went by quickly. So Grigaitis is slowing down just a bit after having two marks in his first four frames. Mike Poulin, on the other hand, showing three marks in his first four, working on a strike
and
here in the fifth.
Trying to fill a strike. He's still looking for some bonus money. He's in the pocket that time, the 1-2 pocket, leaving the five and the nine with some wood angled right into the five pin. Mike walks down to get a better look at the angle of the wood. I don't think the wood hurts him. I'm not sure how much it helps him, but I don't think it hurts him.
He'd rather not have it there. See?
Well,
just enough
hurt
to deflect it, and the nine pin stays.
Nine bucks, a 74 half.
And a rough day at the office for Mike with those spares involving the five pin, either the 5-8 or the 5-9. He's failed to convert both of those opportunities. Could have been all marks so far through five frames.
This is an unusual leave for you right there. The 8 and the 9 standing in the back row.
One of the most difficult spares, really, to make in the game. They're both far enough away from the sidewall that it's going to be tough to get any kickback. And, of course, no wood on the deck to help. So it's chalk this one up as probably a 10 box.
And he picks up one on the left side. That's the 8 pin. Now the 9 pin remains. Yeah, 10 box for Mike Poulin. Now Grigaitis on lane 34. Bounced one down and got a pretty good fall. He leaves 3 pins. The 5, 8, and 9 right in the middle of the lane. We're seeing a lot of pins left standing right in the middle. That time he's not able to convert. Nine box.
So Jim Grigaitis not really taking advantage of the two open frames by Mike Poulin, as he's put open frames against Mike Poulin open boxes here in the eighth frame.
That's a good shot to pick up the four horsemen on the left side for Jim Grigaitis. Well done. A mark for Grigaitis, his third mark of the string. Watch it again. He played it perfectly. Right inside the one and the two. Third mark of the string for Grigaitis. Now Poulin looks to answer. Five pin stands. They call that a solid five pin because it was never touched.
You have to wonder how. Nine other pins around it.
Spare for Poulin in the seventh frame.
Should mention with deep sadness the passing of a couple fixtures in the bowling game over the course of the summer. About a month ago, sorry to say that Norm Burke passed away, diagnosed with Lou Gehrig's disease, ALS, about a year and a half ago. Confined to a wheelchair and did pass away in early September. Our condolences to his family and friends, a bowler well-known in the Haverhill area and certainly in the professional ranks for many, many years. And we also mentioned the passing of the wife of director of the Mass Bowling Association, MBA, Bill Bolton's wife, Sue, also passed away during the summer. I believe it was in August. And if you get a hold of the Boston Globe August 29th, John Valenti does a very nice tribute to both Bill and his late wife, Sue. So our condolences to all their family and friends.
Lou Gehrig disease recently claiming the life of baseball pitcher Catfish Hunter as well. Grigaitis on 34 working on a spare. He'll put six in the mark and leave four standing with some wood. Again, the way that wood is positioned, he might go for it and take a shot at it. No, he's going to go right off the head pin and not convert. Gave it a good run.
On a happy note regarding health, Dick, Tony Zernike is with us today. Tony Zernike with a fall and some illness last year. Wasn't doing all that well, but he is up and around and looking terrific. So we're very happy to see Tony Zernike on hand today.
103 through 9 for Grigaitis. Tony Zernike, of course, from Webster, and a lot of the communications that we received over the summer had to deal with our popular question of spelling Webster Lake and pronouncing Webster
Lake. You're not going to start this one again.
No, I'm not going to do that again. But a lot of people chimed in.
I'd like to see that one on Wheel of Fortune sometime.
I like to buy a bowl. We have 37 vowels.
And Vanna can't keep up.
Grigaitis fills the mark with a strike. That's a way to go out in style. He finishes with a 123 second string. A strong finish for Jim Grigaitis. Now Mike Poulin, who was down three after one on the head pin, but can't bust up the split. Nine box for Mike Poulin, a 120 with a box to go. Ida Can from Tewksbury, Massachusetts, wrote in a nice letter, told us how much she loves Candlepin Bowling and the Boston Red Sox. Well, the Red Sox are making a run as we tape this show.
As we tape, sure. This show originally will air on October 3rd, or is today October 3rd, which just is about the end of the season.
Well, you'll know by now where they are.
You don't want to put your Swami hat on, Dick?
I can't see how they'll miss the playoffs, but again, hindsight. Missing the spare in the 10th frame, Mike Poulin. Anything can happen. 10 box for Poulin, a 130. Second string. A four-pin lead in the match for Mike Poulin as we head to third string action on Candlepin Stars and Strikes from Lita Lanes in Nashua, New Hampshire. Don't go away. We're coming back with the finale in just a minute. Mike. Mike Poulin ready to lead us off in the third string of our opening match of a brand new season of Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV. Mike takes a four-pin lead into the third string, and the pins continue to fall in his first ball.
And I bet he was happy to see the five-pin go, which has not been his friend today.
Now double wood stands in front of the eight-pin, or lays in front of the eight-pin. And
oh,
look at that. The eight-pin still stands. Geometrically, it was impossible.
Boy, that sure looked like a gimme shot.
Put an asterisk next to that one. At the end of the match, it may come back to haunt Mike Poulin. Let's take a look at it again if we have time. We'll get a quick look at it. Look at the wood split.
And the ball even seemed to jump over the pin.
Now a spread eagle plus one.
Well, if that makes you feel any better, Mike, you'd only had a three fill on that spare that never was but should have been. Spread eagle with the nine in the back row.
I want to really congratulate Ray Simoneaux and Sean Howard and the crew at Lita Lanes in Nashua for the work that they have done in the facility during the off season. A new seating arrangement and floor in the bowlers area that you will really not be able to see on camera, but we can see from our end, and you can see the seats.
Yeah, the benches are gone.
The benches are gone, and right. New seats are put in. And they've done some decorative work around the building. It really looks nice, spruced up. And again, they accommodate the fans who come out to our tapings in a first-class manner, and they really do appreciate it. Grigaitis opens with a spare.
The new lavish and fully automated restrooms. Also a very nice addition to the rehab work done here at Lita Lanes.
And by and large, for the most part, we're here the second Tuesday of every month for the next 8 months. If you'd like to come to watch one of our taping sessions, Grigaitis puts a seven in the spare.
Right, a week from Tuesday, the 12th of October will be our next taping date. Right around 10 o'clock is when we start, but get here early for a good seat, right, Dick?
Grigaitis missing the spare. Yeah, people do arrive early. It's a great opening day crowd without a lot of advance notice for the people here today to watch our taping. And Grigaitis takes a nine box. 26 through two for Jim Grigaitis. He takes the lead back. A three-pin lead in the match for Grigaitis with eight boxes to go.
Our runner-up today gets $100, and our runner-up gets $100. The winner will go on to face Chris Sargent next week as we work our way up the ladder. And also our winner today receives a $50 gift certificate from Haverhill Beef Company, 117 Merrimack Street in Haverhill. Their phone number is 978-374-4795. Welcome to Joe Terrazano and his family for putting together nice prize packages for our bowlers this season on Candlepin Stars and Strikes.
Mike Poulin leaves a pin unable to pick up the single pin spare. The second one he's missed in three boxes. He'll take a 10 box. Those are costly misses for Mike Poulin in a very close match. Letter from Thomas Convery of Medford, Massachusetts, who bowls in the Medford Teachers Candlepin Bowling League now in its 71st season. Poulin again with a spare opportunity. Tom Convery says he bowled six straight strikes in one game, and he's been a top three finisher year after year in the league. And a spare.
Six strikes in a
row?
For
Mike Poulin.
Wow.
Six strikes in a row is ain't too shabby. On one occasion, a New York TV crew was doing a segment on a couple who had been married 50 years. A member of the crew came over and asked for his name. And the alley manager sent him because he would throw a strike. And he did. His high single is 186. Bowled a 416, and 2 weeks later, a 456. And he bowls at Malden Square Bowling Lanes, now called Ryan Family Amusements. Thomas Convery of Medford, Massachusetts, thank you very much for that nice letter. Yeah! Grigaitis, will he get it? It will not. It kind of was on its way. It slowed down and came at it again. The wood can be fickle in Candlepin bowling. 10 box for Grigaitis. And now he's up against a Mike Poulin spare in the fourth frame. Looks like this one's going to go right down to the wire, Michael.
It's been within 15 pins almost the entire way.
And that time he didn't grab the head pin, but he's getting a pretty good leave out of it. Again, the two pin danced off its mark. Might be a factor that it's not on its mark.
Gonna want to try to split the one and the two and hope the wood rolls over to take out the seven.
Missed the head pin. The one pin still stands. Ten box for Jim Grigaitis. Mike Poulin will be working on a mark when we come back for the break as Candlepin Stars and Strikes continues from Lita Lanes in Nashua, New Hampshire on WNDS-TV. Mike Poulin working on a spare in the fourth frame as he steps to lane 34 at Lita Lanes. In Nashua, New Hampshire, Grigaitis has a three-pin lead, pending what Mike Poulin gets on this ball. Missed the head pin, and we're dead even. A three-pin fill on a spare. Cannot convert the spare. It'll be an eight box. Kathy and John Gill from South Weymouth, Massachusetts, right in. We watched the Saturday bowling show on Channel 5 in Boston for many years until it was canceled. And Jim Britt, of course, was terrific. And Michael, the commentary to us is that we do a good job, although we'll never be Jim Britt. And we hope you, we in the Kahala restaurant will be with us for years to come.
They mentioned the Kahala restaurant.
The Kahala restaurant.
These people are in Weymouth on South Shore, and they're wow.
Take a look at the spare again for Mike Poulin as he marks in the sixth frame. Speaking of the Kahala restaurant, what are you having for lunch today, Michael?
I'm thinking of some spicy chicken myself.
Well, how about the house special War Bar at the Kahala restaurant in Nashua, right next to Lita Lanes? The house special War Bar combines chunks of lobster meat, chicken, shrimp, and roast pork, mixed with the special Chinese vegetables, mushroom, bamboo shoots, water chestnuts, and a delicious sauce served over a sizzling hot platter. Sounds pretty good, doesn't it?
I think we'll have the buffet, though, won't we?
I think we probably will at the Kahala Chinese Restaurant and Lounge. It's right next door to Lita Lanes in Nashua, New Hampshire, and we look forward to having lunch there every time we come to one of our taping sessions. The Kahala's at 350 Amherst Street. The lunch buffet, $5.95, Monday through Saturday from 11:45 to 2. The dinner buffet is just $8.95 on Thursdays from 5 to 8 and Sundays from noon to 8 p.m. The next time you're in the Nashua area, next time you're coming to Lita Lanes, make sure you stop by the Kahala Chinese Restaurant and Lounge, right next door to Lita Lane's, 350 Amherst Street in Nashua, New Hampshire.
It's a no MSG restaurant, folks.
Grigaitis couldn't get the roll. He's going to be open in this frame. Another 10 box for Jim Grigaitis, four 10s in a row for Grigaitis. Now Mike Poulin is working on a mark, trying to open up a little daylight between he and Grigaitis. Good crossover pocket shot, puts eight in the spare. And a spare opportunity for Mike Poulin. He will convert two marks in a row. So Mike Poulin starts to put a little pressure on Jim Grigaitis.
We've not given any bonus money away today, so this could be the time.
Here's our opportunity right here, another opportunity. We've had a couple of opportunities.
Yeah. It's been an Econo show today. Haven't given too much away.
Can he break up the split? No, but lots of wood on the deck.
Dick, I want to mention the WCBC tournament action is heating up once again. Next weekend, the WCBC October Pro Tournament will be the Invitational Tournament at Park Place Lanes in Wyndham, the former home of Candlepin Stars and Strikes. Saturday the 9th, Sunday the 10th, ladies with 102 or higher for an average and men better than 112 are eligible to enter. Also eligible for all prize money. If you'd like information, call Marianne Kelly if you'd like to be a professional bowler at 781-438-1314. That's 781-438-1314. Head over to Park Place Lanes next weekend and watch the best Candlepin bowlers in the world compete.
Now Mike Poulin has studied this shot. Here he goes.
Oh, who would have guessed the 10 pin would have stayed?
Wow. He took out the 6 and the 7 and the 10 pin is still standing. That's remarkable.
Crowd in a state of disbelief as well. You can hear them buzzing about that.
And a 9 box. Now Grigaitis, who's been open 5 frames in a row, the last 4 of them 10 boxes, he needs to mark. Well, he came in the back door. He left the head pin standing. The 1 and the 3 still stand. Wood is in the way. It's not in a good spot.
Got to avoid it to keep from capping it.
He did cap it and left it standing. It'll be a 9 box for Grigaitis.
Things are slipping away from Mr. Grigaitis. We're still within a couple of marks of Mike Poulin, but we're running out of frames.
He needs a mark right here, badly.
Oh. Ugly, ugly, ugly.
Spread eagle plus the 5 pin.
I don't think I've ever seen this made.
There ought to be a name for this leave. Probably you couldn't say it on television. He's got an opportunity to come out of it with a 10 box, which would really be an accomplishment. He will.
Very nice.
That's a terrific 10 box for Jim Grigaitis. A 13-pin lead for Mike Poulin with 2 boxes to go. He could put it away with a mark in both boxes. 1 mark would make it difficult. And he throws a half Worcester.
Don't go away, folks. This one will go down to the 10th frame. Former Nashua resident Mike Poulin now living in the Seacoast area.
Gave it a good shot, tried to convert. A 9 box. He's at 103.
Come on, Mike, right here.
349 thus far for Mike Poulin.
Chris Sargent standing by next week. Week 3, we'll see Bruno DeFeo taking on the winner of next week's match. Bob Betancourt is our top-seeded bowler. He had a 694 for his roll-off score.
Well, he's leaving the door open for Jim Grigaitis.
Whoa!
went sailing over the seven pin, but left it standing. Grigaitis needs a mark in the last two frames to win the match. One mark will do it. A 113, a 359. 22 pins to tie it, 23 pins to win it.
Considerably down from his 125 average. Nice breaks.
He broke up the split, but it's not an easy shot standing. No. You got the 3, 6, 3, 5, 6, and 10. The 5 still stands. We're going down to the last box. Nine box. 94.
Two strikes and a four pin fill is what Jim Grigaitis needs to do to come back next week to face Chris Sargent. Otherwise, it'll be Mike Poulin advancing. Nope, it's over.
He'll close with a mark, but not enough.
Puts a strike in here, he loses by only three pins. It's not too hard to go back, Dick, and count the frames when one pin or two pins missed. Made the difference today.
A 112 final string and a 354. Mike Poulin with a 359 to Jim Grigaitis, 354. Poulin advances. And we'll come back to meet the Boulders at Lita Lanes in Nashua, New Hampshire, when we continue with Candlepin Stars and Strikes on WNDS-TV.